Structure of DNA. Today we will do the part 2, and in this we will discuss about the characteristic features of the DNA. Now, DNA as an acidic substance present in the nucleus was first identified by Friedrich Miescher. That was in 1869, and he named it as nucleon. So this was the name given to the DNA by Friedrich Miescher in 1869. However, due to technical limitations in isolating such a long polymer intact, because that time it was only in 1953. After 1869, only in 1953, that James Watson and Francis Crick, they proposed the structure, and their structure was based on the X-ray diffraction data. This was produced by Morris Wilkins and Rosalind Franklin. Morris Wilkins and Rosalind Franklin had given the data, X-ray diffraction data, and based on these data, the Watson and Crick, they proposed a very simple but famous double helix model for the structure of DNA. And one of the hallmarks of their proposition was base pairing, the complementary base pairing between the two strands of polynucleotide chains. Now, their proposition was also based on the observation of Erwin Chagaff. Now, he was another scientist who gave this conclusion that in a double-stranded DNA, the ratio between adenine and thymine and guanine and cytosine are constant and equal one. So that means on one strand, whatever are the bases which are present, how much adenine is present, the same amount of thymine is present on the setup. Similarly, this goes for guanine and cytosine. And this is because of the complementary base pairing. The base pairing confers a very unique property to the polynucleotide chains. And what is this unique property? They are said to be complementary to each other. Now, complementary to each other means we know that wherever there is, that means the amount of A is equal to the amount of T, and amount of C is equal to the amount of G. This is because of the complementary base pairing. So the base pairing confers a very unique property to the polynucleotide chains, and this is, they are said to be complementary to each other. Now, complementary to each other means if we know the sequence of bases on one strand, we can predict the sequence of bases on the another strand, because we know that it is always complementary. If there is A, the A will be bonded with the T only. If there is T, the T will be bonded with adenine only. If there is cytosine, it will be bonded with the guanine only. If there is guanine, it will be bonded with the cytosine only. So because of this complementary pairing property, if we know the sequence of bases in one strand, then the sequence of other strand can be predicted. Now, if each strand of a DNA acts as a template for synthesis. Template means there are two strands. Suppose we cut the hydrogen bonds and make the two strands out of that parent DNA. So these two are called templates. Now, templates can also be, we can call them parent DNA. And this parent DNA, the synthesis of new strand is done, and the double-stranded DNA which will be produced would be identical to the parental DNA molecule. Now, how this is happening? Just look at this. See, suppose these are the two strands of DNA, and if we cut them in between and we want to synthesize the DNA, so what will happen? This red red strands. These two red strands would be the parental strands. And these two blue strands are the daughter strands. They are synthesized afterwards. So these two red strands are the parental DNA, which can also be called as template for this synthesis of this DNA. So suppose here it is, the sequence of bases, if we see in this red one, it is A, G, C, T, G. Okay, so now see this A, G, C, T, G. If this is the parent template, then what would be the sequence in the daughter strand? Daughter strand would be having T, C, G, A, C. Now, this is same as the second strand of the parent DNA. Similarly, the second, if we see the second daughter strand, that would also be same as this parent DNA. So that means two identical DNA strands are formed from this one after the replication of DNA. So this is the utmost requirement of the genetic material. Whenever the cell division is taking place, whenever the cell is dividing into two daughter cells, the requirement is that the genetic material should double up. And there should be equal distribution of genetic material into the daughter cells. So this thing, this requirement has been fulfilled by this quality of the DNA. So DNA bases on each strand act as a template to synthesize a complementary strand. Now recall that adenine pairs with thymine and guanine pairs with cytosine. This process is semi-conservative. Semi-conservative means one strand of the parent is used and one strand of daughter is formed. So it is semi-conservative. Half is of parental and half is new. Similarly, here also, half is parental, half is new. So this is how the replication of DNA is taking place. So this is one of the get two copies after the replication, because this template will give this daughter strand and this template would give this. So that is, this clears the genetic implication of the structure of DNA. The salient features of double helix DNA, first of all, it is made up of two polynucleotide chains, two strands, and both are polynucleotide chains. And in both the strands, backbone is what? Sugar and phosphate. Backbone is constituted by sugar and phosphate. And the bases are projecting inside. The two chains have anti-parallel polarity. If one chain has the polarity from 5 prime to 3 prime, the other would have 3 prime to 5 prime. So this is called anti-parallel polarity. Both the strands are anti-parallel to each other. The bases in two strands are paired through hydrogen bond, forming base pair. Now adenine is joined with the thymine by hydrogen bonds. And adenine and thymine, that is called base pair. Adenine is bonded with thymine with two hydrogen bonds. So we put two hydrogen bonds between adenine and thymine. Guanine is bonded with cytosine with three hydrogen bonds and vice versa. The cytosine will be bonded with guanine with three hydrogen bonds. Similarly, the thymine with the adenine will be bonded with the two hydrogen bonds. Now, always a purine comes opposite to a pyrimidine. Like adenine is what? Adenine is purine. And thymine is pyrimidine. So adenine will join with pyrimidine. Similarly, pyrimidine will join with purine. So this is because when they are coming opposite to each other, they generate the approximate uniform distance between the two strands of the helix. Yesterday we saw that two rings of purines and one of pyrimidines. So basically three comes. So the distance is almost approximately uniform between the two strands of the helix. The two chains are coiled in a right-handed fashion. Now, what is right-handed fashion? Right-handed fashion is this. This is right-handed. If you put your right hand, so it will be coiling from the right side. So that is called right-handed fashion. So DNA is this, right-handed helix. See this also, the right hand. This is the straight one. And when this straight one is turned towards the right-hand side, what will happen? This is 5-3, will come to this side, 5. This is 5 and this is 3. And this is 5 to, this is 3 to 5. So it will become 5-2-3. So this is how they are stacked over each other to give the double helical structure. The pitch of the helix is 3.4 nanometer. Now, what is nanometer? A nanometer is 1/1,000,000th of a meter. That is 10⁻⁹ meter. It is a very small distance. So the double helix turns after every 10 base pairs. After every 10 base pairs, roughly, after every 10 base pairs, there is a turn. And this distance is called pitch. This distance is called pitch. So this distance is 3.4 nanometers. Now see this. Where it has turned, between the turn, you will find 10 base pairs after each turn. So 10 base pairs are present, and these 10 base pairs, that is 3.4 nanometer. And there are 10, so that means between each base pair, there is a distance of 0.34 nanometer. 0.34 is the distance between two base pairs. So this is the double helix coiling, and this gives the pitch. This is called the pitch. Here also the same thing is shown. This is 3.4 from here to here. So one turn is there, and in this one turn, you will get roughly 10 base pairs. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Roughly 10 base pairs will come in this. And between two base pairs, the distance is 0.34 nanometers. Now, there are roughly 10 base pairs in each turn. In each turn, which is right-handed, there are 10 base pairs. The plane of one base pair stacks over the other in double helix. Now, what does this mean? The base pairs are stacking over each other, like you are keeping your books in stacks. So, what is happening? They are coming one above the other. So same thing is happening in DNA as well. And this, in addition to the hydrogen bond, this gives further stability to the helical structure. Now, after proposing the structure of DNA, the Watson and Crick, they gave this, proposed this after getting the X-ray diffraction data from the Rosalind Franklin. So what happened? Soon, the Crick proposed the central dogma also in molecular biology. Now, what is central dogma? Central dogma is the flow, the genetic flow of information, which gives that how the genetic information is flowing from DNA and how it is getting converted into a trait. So, this all was made possible because of the a discovery of the synthesis, replication in the DNA. When it was found that the DNA strands can be from DNA to messenger RNA, and this goes to protein. That means the from DNA, messenger RNA is formed, and from messenger RNA, protein is formed, And depending upon the type of the protein which has been formed and the sequence of the amino acid in this protein, the trait is given, the trait is formed in the progeny. And this DNA, what are the different processes which are taking place in central dogma? This DNA is first replicating itself. That means out of one DNA, two strands are formed. So two DNA is double stranded. So this double stranded DNA will give two double strands, daughter DNAs. And this is called replication. Now this DNA will replicate itself and form duplicate itself, the synthesis. This is the synthesis of DNA, which is taking place in the S phase, when we had discussed that this DNA will transcribe itself into messenger RNA. That process is called transcription. From DNA to RNA, it is called transcription. And then from RNA to protein, it is called translation. So this RNA will be translated into proteins, the sequence of amino acids, and this decides the trait. See, the flow of genetic information in a cell. This is central dogma. Now this DNA is replicating itself. That's why this arrow is turning towards DNA only. So this DNA is forming DNA, that is replication. Then DNA is forming RNA, that is transcription. Then this RNA is sending this genetic information and forming proteins. This is called translation. And then this protein will decide the trait. What trait is going to be the genotype and phenotype of the progeny is decided by what type of protein is formed from this DNA. So this is central dogma. Now in some viruses, as I told you that in some viruses where the genetic material is RNA, it's not DNA, the flow of information is in reverse direction because they are having RNA. So RNA will get converted into DNA. So it is reverse. It is reverse in reverse direction the information is going. And this flow of information from DNA to RNA is called transcription. So the reverse information can be called reverse transcription. So here in case of viruses, where RNA is the genetic material, this RNA will form the DNA and this is called reverse transcription. This RNA will form the DNA and this is called reverse transcription because RNA is the genetic material in case of viruses. So this is reverse transcription. This is all about the central dogma.